Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
I want to encourage you, if you have not read John the 10th chapter, you need to, after tonight, maybe sometime this week, just sit down and read through it. Jesus makes some amazing statements in this chapter. Obviously, most of us are familiar with John chapter 10, verse number 10. I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And how Jesus talks about the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But in this, Jesus gives us a picture of who he is and what he does. This is also a picture of the present-day ministry of Jesus in our lives. You know, sometimes people wonder, what is Jesus doing right now? You know, like, is he just chilling? Is he just sitting next to the Father? Did he finish his work and now he's not doing anything else? But Jesus has a present-day ministry. He is actively interceding on behalf of the church. Jesus is active there with the Father. And in fact, if you read in the book of Acts, you'll find that when Stephen was stoned, he was the first martyr of the church, that he looked up to heaven and saw Jesus not seated at the right hand of God, but standing at the right hand of the Father. So Jesus was there sitting at the right hand of God, and when Stephen was going through his trial, Jesus stood up on his behalf. So tonight I believe that we're going to get a picture of what is Jesus doing in our life. Title of tonight's message is this: Jesus, the entrance to life. Jesus, the entrance to life. I just want to take one verse. You know, sometimes we come to church and we think about, you know, the preaching of the gospel, the sermon, right? You've heard that term, or the message that's going forth. But I believe that every time we come together, and you'll notice this about the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, is that we come together and we open up the Word of God. This is a Bible study. This is where we come together and where we open up the Word and we find out what God is speaking to us. And you can take these same principles that we're applying tonight when we look at John the 10th chapter to your studies. When you go home and when you open up your Bible and when you start to listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit, I believe that you're going to see some simple things tonight as we go through this. That if you will apply these in your life, that your own personal Bible studies are just going to come alive and they're going to be deep and meaningful times with the Holy Spirit. John chapter 10, verse number 9. Look at what Jesus says. We're just going to look at this one verse tonight. And we'll launch out from there into some other spots. But John chapter 10, verse number 9 says this. Jesus is speaking and he says these words. He says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. And will go in and out and find pasture. Now Jesus is speaking in basically a parable. He's using a similitude or a likeness. He's saying that he is the door, that if anybody's going to do something, what, enter by me, he will be saved. And he's going to go in and out, and he's going to find pasture. Now, he continues on, and he's talking about how the people that are entering in, the people that are coming to Jesus, that they are his sheep. And he also is the shepherd. Now, we understand that terminology. We know that Jesus is called the great shepherd of the sheep. And so we see here that Jesus is using these same shepherd terms. He's using these same terms that they would understand from their society, because they had, right outside of Jerusalem, if you went just a little ways away, there was Bethlehem. And there were the shepherds there, and the very famous ones that were watching their flocks by night. So all around Jerusalem, there would have been people who would have been out there herding sheep, and they would have understood the society, they would have understood the terms. We're going to take a look at some of those things tonight. But I want to see what happens when we enter by the door. Because Jesus identifies himself. He says, I am the door. So that means that when we enter by the door, in this one little verse, there are some things that we're going to see, actually four of them tonight, that we're going to see that take place when we enter by the door. First one is this. When we enter by the door, we will be saved. We will be saved. Look at what it says in John chapter 10, verse number 9. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. So right off the bat, we find out something. He will be saved. Now, I don't know about you, but in my personal Bible studies, when I read something, oftentimes all I have to do to go deeper into the study or deeper into the Word of God is just ask myself a question. He will be saved. From what? Now, the obvious answer there is he will be saved from hell. We know that. Hell is a very real place. It's all throughout the Bible. You can find it in the Old Testament. You can find it in the New Testament. Nobody wants to go to hell, right? unless they've got some weird deceived notion of what hell is, that it's going to be some party and there's going to be, you know, frisbee and beer and all that. That's not hell. Hell is a place of eternal torment. And if we really understood what hell was all about, we would do everything we could not only to keep ourselves out of it, but we would preach a lot harder and tell a lot more people about it. Because it's a place that no one wants to go, and you don't even want your worst enemy to go there. Because they're lost and they do not know what they do. Lord, forgive us. Lord, help us. But not only we're saved from hell, but how about this? We're saved from the wrath of God. See, hell is one thing. Hell is a place of eternal torment. Why? Because the wrath of God is being stored up for those that are disobedient. And therefore, if the wrath of God is not on Jesus, then it's on me. See, Jesus is the door. If I enter by him, then I am saved. Saved from hell, yes, but also saved from the wrath of God. The Bible says that our God is a consuming fire, and it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And therefore, we need to have a respect and an awe of God, that God, you know, you sent Jesus to the cross, not just because you love me, but to take away my sin, as well as to take the wrath of God, the punishment for sin. See, Jesus was the substitute. He took our place. That cross, that punishment, and that wrath that was poured out on Jesus, that cup that he drank down to the very dregs, that was meant for me. And yet if I enter by the door, if I come in by Jesus, then that no longer is mine because Jesus took it away from me. So I'm saved. Saved from what else? Saved from myself. Saved from my sinful flesh dragging me down. Saved from the way that I used to be. See, that old man is no longer the man that I am. That old man died now because I have entered by the door. I have been born again now, and now I'm a new creation, and now I am saved from even myself. Starting to preach good now. See, just as Noah entered the ark and was safe, he entered by the door, right? And he was safe. You remember Lot, when they were coming to try and take him out, he was standing at the door and he was safe. Same thing in our lives. If we enter in by the door, we will be saved. Now, not only are we saved from these things, but we are saved from death to life. Thought about that? I'm saved from hell to heaven. I am saved from sin to righteousness. I am saved from death to life. See, Jesus is using shepherd terms. And in this day and age, they didn't have really like the sheep pens like we would understand them today. You know, big square boxes where they're opening the gate, right? And they let all the sheep come in and the dog comes running, all that kind of stuff. They didn't have that. What they would do as shepherds is they had a staff and they had a rod. And that rod was for protection. If a wolf came and tried to take any of the sheep out, they would take up that rod and they would beat that wolf, right? They would hit it. But they also had a large staff, and that staff, they could guide the sheep. They could push them this way or guide them over here, that sort of a thing. And what they would do is they would guide these sheep out to a pasture, but then there would be a time where they would need to take them into a safe place. And so what they would do to get them safe is that they would take them into an area that was naturally sort of round or was sort of constricted, right? A place where they could only enter in one way. In fact, when I was in Israel myself for my travels, we went into a cave where they believe it was a lambing cave where Jesus was born. See, in a cave, all throughout Bethlehem, there's these little caves. In a cave, there's one entrance in. And as you enter into that small cave, the sheep could go inside there. And then the shepherd himself, when he would get all the sheep inside, what he would do is he would lay himself down at the entrance to that cave. Why would he do that? So that if the sheep tried to come this way, they had to get through the shepherd. And he'd say, no, go back. No, we're not going that way, right? And he'd get out his staff and he would guide them back in, that sort of a thing. They would have to step over him. So even if he fell asleep there at the door, he would wake up because the sheep was walking all over him. No, you get back in there. And if a wolf tried to come in, that wolf had to come across the shepherd. So the shepherd, if he saw a wolf coming across, he would grab his rod and he would stand up and he would protect the sheep behind him and he wouldn't let that wolf come and get the sheep. Now, think about it this way. When the shepherd did that, the shepherd became the door. You see? The shepherd is now the door. If you're reading in maybe one of the newer translations, they say, Jesus says, I am the gate, right? The shepherd was the gate. He laid down at the entrance to that area, and now no one could come through, no one could go in or out without getting through him. He had to be the physical door. Jesus is saying that to us, that when we go in through the door, when we go in through him, now we are safe. That wolf, that prowling wolf, that roaring lion, the devil, he cannot come through Jesus to get to you. See, he's got to get through Jesus first, but Jesus already whipped him. So if you've entered in by the door, you are safe from the devil. You don't have to worry about the devil. You have authority over the devil. He's already a defeated foe. Jesus defeated him at the cross. He no longer has authority or power. And now you can say, you want to get to me, devil? You got to go through the door. But Jesus isn't letting you in. He's stronger than you are. He beat you, and you cannot come against me. And you can send him back in the name of Jesus. Very familiar verse, John 14, 6. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except how? Through me. Why? Because he's the door. What about this? Turn to me to the book of Romans, if you will. Romans chapter 5. Keep your finger there in John chapter 10. We'll come back there. But Romans chapter 5 uses some interesting terminology in the first two verses. Romans chapter number 5. Starting in verse number 1 and going through verse number 2, look at what it says. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through the door, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to know something. Remember, we said we are saved from the wrath of God. Before we went through the door, we were enemies of God. We were outside. We were at war with God. The Bible calls it enmity if you read it in the book of Ephesians. You were at enmity with God. You were at war with God. Now, think about that for a second. If you were warring against God, that meant that God was opposed to you. That meant that God was against you. And that meant that you were fighting a losing battle against God. That you were gonna die, the wrath of God would have been poured out upon you, and you were headed to hell. But now that you've entered by the door, you have been justified. What does that mean? That means that the gavel has come down now, and it's just as if you had never sinned. You have been declared innocent by God. That old sinful man is now gone. You've entered through the door and you've been justified by faith, believing God at his word. We have peace with God. So you no longer have to fear God in the sense of the wrath of God anymore for sin. That means that you don't have to say, oh my goodness, I messed up. Is God going to cast me off forever? No, you confess it to the Lord. You repent of that sin. You change your mind. You change your way. And you keep going God's way. And God brings you right back in. And God says, okay, let's keep going. Let's clean that up. Let's change. Let's get going on with this. See, you don't have to fear the wrath of God for sin. Why? Because that was already poured out on Jesus at the cross. So we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. But look at verse number 2. Take a look at what it says. Through whom? Notice through once again. See, we're entering in through the door, through Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access. See, before you didn't have access because you didn't enter in by the door. Jesus said anybody who came in another way was a thief and a robber. That was us before we were saved. Lying, cheating, stealing, trying to get our own way. But now that we've entered in by the door, we have access by faith into this grace, this ability, in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. See, we are saved from death to life. We read John chapter 10, verse number 9, and then right after that, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. You can only access it by going through the door. Second thing we see, turn back with me to John chapter 10, verse number 9. Take a look at what it says. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and we'll go in. Now, let's stop right there for a second. Second thing is this for tonight, is that we will go in. When we enter by the door, we will go in. You say, didn't we just cover that? You're safe, right? You're safe because you're in. But there's something about going in. Because God says that he gathers us together. That's what the term, if you've ever heard of it, a sheepfold, right? They fold the flock of God. What do? They gather them in. As a sheep of God's pasture. Now as we enter by the door, we shall not only be safe, but now also we shall go in. Let's take a look at what this means to us. We go into what? We go into his life. We talked about that. This includes his protection, but this also includes his provision, his abundance, His ability, his blessings. We talked about that. Now we rejoice in hope. Why? Because we've got access to this life. We've got access to this grace in which we now stand. Now as we go in, we now have the ability, the authority, the power of God on our lives. But what else do we go into? It's amazing when you take a look at it. We go into his presence. Think about that. If you are entering in by the door and the door is Jesus, then now you are entering into the presence of Almighty God. Before you were alienated, before there was a wall of separation, before you could not come to God. The psalmist wrote and said, if I had cherished sin in my heart, he would not have heard my prayers. See, before we were saved, we were sending up prayers thinking, God, bless me. God, give me $1 million. God, why don't you do something about this? God, I don't see this the right way. But then finally, we entered in by the door. And now when we say God, God says, yes, son. Yes, daughter. See, you are right there in the presence of God. Now, you never leave the presence of God. God is always with you. Wherever you go, he goes. Whatever you're doing, he's right there with you. Now, that works two ways right there. That could either be good or bad. That could be a scary thing. God, you're with me when I'm doing that? Whoa. Time to clean up our acts. But God is with you. You're in his presence. Into what else? Into his promises. See, we were strangers and aliens, foreigners to the covenants, but now we have come into the promises of God. And now the Bible says in him, in Jesus Christ, in that door as we enter in, all the promises of God in him are yes and are amen to the glory of God the Father. I'm preaching better than you guys are responding tonight. I didn't think I needed to tell you needed to say amen. What else? Now we go in to his family. See, we all had earthly families. Some of us had good parents. I had great parents. I love my mom and dad. They're wonderful. Love my brother. Had a great, great upbringing. Some of us not so great. You know, when I think about my dad and my mom, they had parents that abused them, beat them up, neglected them, left them, did horrible things to them. But what matters is not who your mom and dad are. What matters is not who your granddaddy or who your grandma is. What matters is not who's your uncle or your cousins. What matters is not where you were born or what location or what demographic or what area or what economic or social status. What matters is are you or are you not a part of the family of God? Have you entered in through the door and now are you a part of the family of God? Because once you enter into this family, oh my goodness, you got a rich dad. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. All is God's, and now God has given it to the sons of man. See, we have an inheritance. We believe God for great and mighty things, and now God says, I will give you an inheritance among the nations. I will pour out my spirit upon you. I will supply your every need. And in case you're wondering if I'm talking about money, that's the least amount of what I'm talking about right now. Think about having a life that's fulfilled. Think about having a purpose that gets you up out of bed every day. Think about having a mission and a calling of being a part of something that's bigger than yourself. Think about having people who love you unconditionally and who will weather the storms with you, who will hold up your arms when you're getting weak and weary, when your hand has just gotten ice to the sword because you've been fighting so long and you don't know how you're going to make it. They've got your back. See, you are a part now of the family of God, not only here in this church, but globally. There are Christians all around the world that call you brother, that call you sister, that are praying for you at this very hour, that love you, and that we're going to be with them forever and ever in heaven. You are a part of the family of God. I don't know if you guys are getting anything. I'm just preaching to myself tonight. I'll just keep going. Isaiah chapter 40, verse number 11, look at what it says. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. Think about that. This is the tenderness of God. God says when he brings you in, he's not kicking you. Get in there, you stupid sheep. God's not abusing the sheep. That rod was not meant for the sheep. That rod was meant for the wolves. He will guide you with his staff just gently, guiding and directing you. Look at what it says. He'll gather the lambs with his arm. That's the young ones. That's the weak ones that couldn't keep up. If you're trailing behind, God will gather you. God will just come down and scoop you up with his arm. And look at what it says. He holds them in his bosom. That means he holds them close to his heart. If you felt like you haven't been able to keep up with this Christianity thing, you feel like you're so young and you don't know anything, Just realize that you are close to the heart of God right now. God will carry you in his arms. God will hold you close. He will love you. He's probably just showering you with kisses and blessings and just love. There's warmth there in his arms. He's leading you up. And look at what it says, and gently lead those who are with you. See, sometimes people wonder, did God forget me? I've been in this Christian faith thing so long, it seems like I've plateaued. It seems like I'm carrying others. It seems like I'm doing the work of the ministry. And look at what it says. He will gently lead. God says, come on, you can do it. You can make it. You're not forgotten. I still got you. Yeah, I'm holding the lamb, but guess what? You're no less important to me. You're no less loved to me. I know you can take it. I know how strong you are. I know the road you've walked, and I know what I've carried you across. I know the slump that you got in when you were downcast and you fell in that ditch and I pulled you out and dusted you off and cleaned you up and set your feet upon the rock. See, God knows where we're at in life, and God will deal with us in a loving and gentle fashion. God is tender and God is loving. We will go in. But look at what else it says in John chapter 10, verse number 9. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he will go in and out. Now, once again, I had to stop and ask a question. Why, if it's so good in there, would anybody want to go out? Is that right? Anybody else have that same question? Well, wait a second. If there's protection, provision, if there's love, if there's care, if there's God, the family, why would I ever want to leave? But notice there are people who would take a look at Christianity and they would say, oh, you guys are just so constricted. It's just a bunch of rules, bunch of do's and don'ts right next to your these and thous. Now, I don't want to have any part of that. I'm free to live however I want to live and do whatever I want to do. And they don't even realize they're in a cage. They're in bondage. See, when you enter in by the door, now you have real freedom. You can go in and out. You've got access. But guess what else? You've got purpose and you've got a mission. See, because you go out when the shepherd says, okay, it's time to get out. Right? You stay in the sheepfold, you're going to get fat and lazy. God doesn't want you fat and lazy. God wants you strong. God wants you healthy. God wants you growing. God wants you feeding. God wants you running. God sends us on mission. And God sends us out into a lost and dying world. Why? So that we can find those that are lost and bring them into the door. Bring them back to the shepherd. Because there is no life outside. There is only chains and bonds. But see, we have true freedom in Jesus Christ. And we can live a life of purpose and value. We can go in and we can go out. We may be sheep, but with our shepherd's strength and wisdom, we are mighty. Come on, somebody. We are mighty. Keep your finger there in John and turn a book back to the book of Luke chapter 10 this time. Luke chapter 10, Jesus, the great shepherd, is speaking to his disciples. Luke chapter 10, he just appoints 70 people in addition to the 12. He's sending them out to every place where he was about ready to go. He's going to go minister, and so he starts sending them out for ministry. And look at what he says to him, verse number 2, Luke chapter 10, verse number 2. Then he said to them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send, what's that next word? It's just three little letters. Come on, what's that next word?
Out.
See, when we enter by the door, we can go in and
out.
Oh, come on, you got to play with me tonight. Okay, I know you're waiting to play checkers. You got to play with me tonight. You got to, when you are entering by the door, now you can go in and what?
Out.
In and out. Now you're hungry for burgers. You got hot dogs and tacos. Pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Now, look at what he said. He said, pray that God will send laborers out into the harvest, okay? Now, I want you to notice that verse number 3 is right after verse number 2. This is significant. Why? Because if you just took one without the other, you wouldn't understand the connection that's about to be made. Look at verse number 3. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs among wolves. In other words, when we pray the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into the harvest fields, and when we realize the need of humanity and that that need is greater than what we can do on our own. And we say, Lord, I can see the fields ripe with grain. There are people out there who need Jesus, and they are ready, they are primed, all they need is someone to go out and gather them in. Lord, I ask that you will send laborers into the harvest. The very next thing that God does is he commissions you as a believer, and he sends you out into the harvest fields. You are the answer to your own prayers. Isn't that amazing? God sends us out, and he sends us out as lambs among wolves. You say, well, that's not a fair fight. Oh, yes, it is. Because remember, you don't go anywhere that Jesus doesn't go. He's going with you. So the shepherd is going to go out with you. The shepherd's going to take care of you. The shepherd is going to watch over you. The shepherd is going to give you success. The shepherd's going to give you strength. The shepherd's going to give you wisdom. The shepherd's going to take care of you. And if any wolf comes at you, the shepherd's going to take out his rod, and he's going to take out that devil. Last one is this. John chapter 10, verse number 9. One last time, take a look at what it says. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out. And oh, I like this one. He will find pasture. He will find pasture. You know what that means? It means that our hunger will be satisfied. See, in life, we're going to be left lacking because it's a dry and thirsty land out there. It is a wasteland out there. And unless we enter in by the door, unless we go in by our shepherd Jesus, then when we go out, we're going to get lost. You know, sheep are not very smart. If you look at the animals, they will get caught in ditches. They will get off track. They will go and eat and nibble, 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 and they will find themselves off the path, find themselves starving. And yet, that's why the shepherd goes after the sheep and brings them in and takes them out, and then he takes them to pasture. Our hunger will be satisfied. If we never entered, we'd be wandering around aimlessly and would have been devoured. But now that we have entered in, we can be fulfilled in every area of our life. God will satisfy your hunger. God will satisfy your needs. God will satisfy your family. God will satisfy your marriage. God will satisfy your business. God will satisfy your future and your destiny. If you're single in this place, I know sometimes we start talking about kids and marriage and all that kind of stuff. You feel like you're left out, and you walk away maybe a little bit lonely. But can I tell you something? In that arena of your life, God can satisfy you as a single person. God can take care of every need individually, successfully, and abundantly because he is God, and he is the great shepherd of the sheep. And God good. Revelation, last book in the Bible, Revelation chapter 7. Pretty awesome when you take a look at it. Revelation chapter 7. Last two verses in Revelation chapter 7. So find chapter 8 and back up two verses. Look at what it says. Revelation chapter 7, verse number 16 and 17. It says, they shall neither hunger anymore nor thirst anymore. But the sun shall not strike them, nor any heat. Verse 17, for the Lamb. Now notice the capital L. That's talking about Jesus. Isn't it interesting that Jesus was the Lamb of God? But look at what else he is, who is in the midst of the throne, will shepherd them. So that means there is a lamb shepherding the sheep. Isn't that cool? You know why it's like that? Because Jesus identified with us in every possible way in a human form. He came in the flesh. That's why he is the Lamb of God. He's the firstborn of God. He was the spotless lamb who qualified to be the sacrifice, and he identifies with us. Think about it in the natural. A shepherd cannot talk to the sheep. Is that right? Sheep starts talking to the shepherd, he's going to freak out and run. But if a sheep is shepherding the other sheep, then the sheep can communicate on their level. Is that right? So here, they're not going to be hungry. They're not going to thirst anymore, nor will the sun strike them. They're not going to be wandering around where they're exposed. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. What an amazing picture. You remember what Jesus said to the woman at the well? He says, if you drink of this water, you will thirst again. But the water I give, if you drink of it, you will never thirst again. Isn't God good? I I want to end with this, a very familiar psalm. We've been talking about shepherds and sheep and all that tonight. Jesus is the door. Turn to me to the book of Psalms, chapter number 23. I want to read it with some new eyes tonight, with some new understanding. Talking about that we will go out and we will find pasture. Psalm 23, starting in verse number 1, look at what it says. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. There's not going to be any desire in me. God fulfills everything in my life. Look at that. Verse number 2, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. Oh my goodness. Pastures, if you look at that literally, it means pastures of tender grass. Doesn't that just sound satisfying right now? I'll go get a wheatgrass shot right afterwards. He leads me beside the still waters. And that, you just think about that. It's just like a place of serenity. Tender grass, still waters. You can just walk up and take a drink. Verse 3, he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Verse 4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Makes sense now, doesn't it? See, even though we're walking through this valley of the shadow of death, see, this is not the real death. Now that you've entered in, you are born again, and now you no longer, you've already experienced that first passing away. Your spirit man had died, but now you've been born again, and you will not experience the second death. What you experience in this flesh, this tent body, is just a shadow. It's just a casting off of this tent, and then you will put on your eternal tent and be with Jesus forever. So while I'm here on the earth, I don't fear anything. Why? Because if you take away this body, doesn't matter. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Therefore, do what you're going to do. I don't care. I'm going to tell you about Jesus. I'm going to tell you unashamed. I'm going to talk to you about heaven and hell, and I'm going to tell you about it. Why? Because Jesus is with me, and I'm not concerned about this flesh suit. Look at verse 5. You prepare a table. See, there's a hunger that we have, and God knows our hunger. God knows our desire, but he prepares a table. Look at this, before me, in the presence of my enemies. You know what that means? They're watching while God sets the table for you. Woo, my goodness. Wait a second, you mean God is waiting on me? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He prepares a table for you in the presence of your enemies. You don't have to worry about them. You anoint my head with oil. That was a picture of health and satisfaction. That was a priestly picture. That was a kingly picture in the Old Testament. If you look at that, they would anoint their heads with oil to be fresh and to be awake and aware. And they anointed themselves for service, whether to be a king or a priest. God calls us kings and priests here on the earth. My cup runs over. You thirsty? You want some more? That cup is still flowing. You better get a drink. See, if you drink of this water, you will never thirst again. Verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. You don't have to run around looking for good things. You don't have to run around looking for the mercies of God. They're following you. Everywhere you go, they go. Every place you're at, they're at. They're just following you around like a couple of lost puppy dogs, just following you, waiting for you to take them home. And they'll go with you there too. Look at what it says. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. There's no greater pasture than when we get to go and be with God forever and ever. Tonight, what did we learn? Four things. Four things that Jesus is the door. When we enter by the door, number one, we will be saved. Number two, we will go in. Number three, we'll go out. And number four, we will find pasture. Isn't that a neat little Bible study tonight? Let's do this. I don't know everybody here tonight. It'd be a tragedy if we had such a good time here in the house of God, worshiping and praising the Lord, getting into the presence of God. Some of you guys knelt down here on your knees and had an encounter with God. It'd be a tragedy if we heard the word of the Lord and experienced God's word like this tonight and learned some things and got some wisdom from God on some things. It'd be a tragedy if we did all that and then I said, hey, go have fun and connect and eat and, you know, play games and all that kind of stuff. And you had such a great time in church and you went home and your heart wasn't right with God and you died and you ended up in hell rather than in heaven. Tonight I've been talking about Jesus, been talking about the door. Oftentimes, people think that because they know who Jesus is, that that gets them right with God. Well, Pastor, I know that. I've heard that scripture before. I could quote John 10:10 to you. I understand all that. In fact, Pastor, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child? Maybe you came tonight because of baby dedication. And you were dedicated as a child, and you remember that. Maybe you think that because you were born in America, and America's a Christian nation, everybody knows who Jesus is in America. We're all Christians. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians. Tonight, can I love you enough and respect you enough, honor you enough to tell you the truth and not play games? If that's how you think you're going to get to heaven because you know something about God, or because you were raised in church, or because you were born in America, that makes you a Christian, that nothing could be further from the truth, you're not going to make it. And if you were to die tonight, you would end up in hell and not go to heaven. I'm not trying to be rude, not trying to be offensive. I'm just stating the truth according to God's word. Because unless you enter in by the door, you won't be saved. You say, well, what does that mean? Does that mean that I got to do good works? Yeah, I used to be bad. I cleaned up my act. Been really good. Done a lot of good deeds. Given money to charities. Helped my neighbors out. Been nice to people. Doesn't that mean that God's going to let me to heaven because I've been good? Doesn't that mean that I've entered in by the door? Well, no, in fact, it doesn't. Doesn't that nowhere in the Bible say how good you have to be? There's no grading scale, no curve, no line that you have to be above. It doesn't work like your good has to outweigh your bad, and God will measure that and then let you into heaven if it tips the scales the right way. It doesn't work like that. Nowhere in the Bible say, just be good and you get to heaven. There's going to be a lot of good people that go to hell. And tonight, I love you enough and respect you enough and honor you enough to not play games and tell you the truth. If you think you're going to get to heaven based on your good works, you're not going to make it. In fact, if you read your Bible, the Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And our good works compared to God's goodness are like filthy rags. You're going to get thrown out, not going to get to make it. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, hold on a second. My last church I got involved, I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. I taught in the Bible classes, even got a membership card. I wouldn't have done that stuff if I wasn't a Christian, right? Well, wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you help out in church or volunteer, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions, or even teach that you get to go to heaven? God is not waiting at the gates of heaven looking for membership cards to a church before you can enter. If that's how you think you're going to get to heaven, you're not going to make it. See, everybody look up at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about mental ascent towards God, knowing who God is, and that gets you right with God. It's not about being able to quote some scriptures or any of that kind of stuff, because the devil knows who Jesus is. The devil can quote scriptures, and yet the devil is not going to heaven for eternity. So this is not about what you've done with your head. It's not about your good works. Rather, this is about your heart. How do we really get saved? Here's how. Jesus said it like this: you must be born again. I used that term a couple times in the message tonight. But let's define what being born again is, because sometimes people hear that term and they say, well, being born again, I've heard about that in the movies, read about that in books, saw it on the internet. And you know, it looked kind of weird, and I didn't really like it, and I'm kind of uncomfortable. You're wanting me to do that right now. But can I tell you something? Let's not define what being born again is by what the world says. Let's define being born again by what the Bible says, not by what I say or the churches out there say or anybody else. What does God say about it? What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. In the book of Revelation, last book of the Bible, we were in chapter 7 tonight. You remember that? Last book of the Bible, chapter 3, Jesus is speaking to a church. So that proves to me you can't just sit in church and call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. Because what he says to this church is, when I come, I better find you hot, or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Those are gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he talking about? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, a little out. A little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight I'm going to give you an opportunity to enter in by the door. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, your call, your choice. In a moment, here's your opportunity. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count out. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's push past that embarrassment tonight. Why? Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. No one's that dumb. And yet the devil thinks that you are. That's why he's pushing you. Don't do it. You're going to be embarrassed. They're looking at you. They'll know. Listen, no one's criticizing. No one's judging you. No one's condemning you. This is a safe and friendly church. We love you. We want you to do this. In fact, if you got invited here tonight, can I tell on the person that invited you? They wanted you to do this. That's why they invited you, because they want you to enter into this wonderful, abundant life that Jesus offers. God loves you so much. He sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross, a public spectacle for all to see, giving you all of his heart, giving God, giving you all of his life. Now, will you do the same for God? Will you give him all of your heart, all of your life, acknowledging your need for Jesus by simply raising your hand? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Come on, make sure before you leave this place. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? Come on, I'm speaking to you. It's time to enter in by the door. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Come on, get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or online, wherever you're at, all around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God watches. If you're on campus, if you're in the foyer or down there, telling us or come into the church service right afterwards. Online, you can minimize your screen and click the blue button to respond to God, or go to our homepage, How to Know God. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high if you need to do this. Thank you. There's one, two, three. Thank you. Four, five, six. Thank you. Seven, eight. God bless you guys. Eight, nine. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Nine wise people already. 10, 11. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you guys. Who else tonight that I did not already see? If I saw you, you can put your hand down. I think I got you already. Thank you. There's about, what did I say, 11 wise people? One. Who else tonight? 12. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? If I didn't already see you, or you're just saying, I wonder if I should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Anybody else real quick? Want to make sure that you're able to enter. The door is open for you. Who else tonight? Who else tonight? You're saying, yeah, I know I need to do this. Need to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Is there anybody else? We've got about a dozen wise people. Thank you. 13, 14. All right. God bless you guys. We got 15. Got you. 16. Thank you. Spirit of God's just working on your heart. If you feel like your heart's about to pump out of your chest, come on, that could be the Spirit of God speaking to you right now. God just read your mail. You say, man, how did he know? Spirit of God speaking to you right now. About 16 wise people. Anybody else real quick? Number 17, that's you. Just raise up your hand real high when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Anybody else over here? Anybody else in the center sections? Anybody else? On this side, anybody else? Back in the family rooms? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 17 wise people, 16 or 17. Hallelujah. God is so good. All those of you that raised your hand, all 16 of you, 17 of you, or if you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, it's not too late. Don't get saved just by raising your hand. I want to lead you in a prayer. I want to bring you down here and let's change destinies together. Okay, so let's all stand. And if that's you, you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, just make your way to the front right now. If you need a friend to come with you, grab your friend and come on down. Get your purse, Bible, sweater, friend if you need a friend. Come on, right now. Make your way to the front. Just as you are. They're coming. Come on. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. If your children are with you, you can bring them. They're welcome. Bring them on down. Just as you are. From the family rooms, from the foyer, wherever you're at. You need to do this. Come on. Come on down right now. God's tugging at your heart.
Come receive. Come and live forever.
Anybody else, if you need to come, come on. Just make your way to the front right now. They're still coming. Come on. You can come too. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Hallelujah. They're still coming. Come on, don't hold back. Don't hold back. Come on, let's encourage them. Church, nudge your neighbor. Say, I'll go with you, friend. And you just come right now. Come on down. All right, you guys. Hey, put a big smile on your face. This is not a bad thing. This is a good thing, okay? Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. Real good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to enter in through the door. Jesus. Going to be born again, brand new from the inside out. And that message that you heard tonight, you're going to be able to apply immediately. Go in, come out, find pasture. Wow. What a neat thing. Okay? So he'll lead you in that prayer. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about what you just did. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next, okay? It's free literature. It's easy reading. If you read slow, you might read it in maybe 20, 30 minutes, okay? It just helps you get your bearings. Okay, now that I'm a Christian, what do I do, okay? I'm going to give you a hint. Get back to church. You're going to grow in your relationship with God as you get into the house of God and hear his voice, okay? And then final thing he's going to do, he's going to offer you absolutely free what we call a spiritual personal trainer. Heard of a physical trainer at the gym? You go to the gym, they assign someone to you, right? They're making sure you're working out the right way, making sure you're eating the right things, right? Okay, spiritual personal trainer, someone who will do that for you spiritually, okay? They're a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to your old ways. That's that old man. No, that you go on with the new man. Go on with the new ways, following Jesus, okay? It's easy and it's free and you need to do it, okay? Now, listen, give us a year, 1 year of your life. Here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, sitting consistently under the teaching. As you do and you apply the Word of God, following the great shepherd, Jesus, I promise you, you will look around your life and say, oh my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everyone? Take their word for it, all right? You guys will just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way, and then he'll let you come right back out right afterwards, okay? Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.